Now this of course requires significant upfront investment presented by the blue, which manifests itself in savings over the long term after we hit that point. Okay, so turning to Australia's actions, starting with fossil fuels. So the world has a dangerous overabundance of fossil fuels relative to the capacity of our environment and atmosphere to safely absorb them. World fossil fuel reserves contain carbon that when burned would release around 8 times the emissions needed to blow the 2-degree carbon budget. And you can see there that Australia's coal reserves alone would basically, if burnt, blow the existing remaining carbon budget on their own. So there can only really be one conclusion. After a brief transitionary period, fossil fuels must be left within the ground. Now, whilst a climatic imperative, this is not something that's been widely talked about in the international community, it's fair to say. And we outline a number of steps that Australia can take to redress that. But just to provide a brief bit of context, I mentioned before that coal prices are actually likely to go down from their current level, by the red circle, in the next few years. Just as countries need to be decisively moving away from coal, they'll become more attractive as the price is projected to drop slightly. Okay, so we argue that on fossil fuels, Australia should initiate a bold international campaign for a global fossil fuel phase-out. We should start by implementing a moratorium on new Australian coal and gas projects, coal and gas expansions. We think that this would have, we argue this would have three substantial impacts. First of all, it would affect the price. Now, of course, this depends precisely on the supply curves for fossil fuels, but we think there's good reason that Australia's moratorium would have a substantial impact on fossil fuel prices and bring those up to at least keep them where they are currently. And this is largely because Australia is simply such a huge proportion of the projected growth in traded coal and gas. And no other countries or private investors have planned for an Australian moratorium for these projects not to go ahead. And of course, when it comes to ramping up supply elsewhere, building new coal mines and infrastructure is not like turning on the tap. New mines often take around 10 years from permitting to full production. And of course, this is the critical decade, and it's the next few years where we really need to influence the strategic choices about energy in developing countries. So there's good reason to think that our export gap from the moratorium, at least, wouldn't be able to be filled for quite some time by other countries. And the second impact, of course, is that it will massively raise investor risk perceptions on investing in coal and gas. And similarly, it will focus global political attention. There's no question that such a move from the world's largest coal exporter and quite soon to be largest LNG exporter would focus the international community's mind on the issue of fossil fuels and climate change. We argue that this moratorium should form the centrepiece of a broader diplomatic campaign by Australia to phase out fossil fuels cooperatively globally and replace them with renewable energy resources. The second aspect is that we should garner that, utilise that political attention that our moratorium generates to convene world leaders from fossil fuel exporting and importing nations to negotiate the immediate terms of the fossil fuel phase-out and renewable energy ramp-up strategy in the best and fairest way possible, consistent with a safe carbon trajectory. Now, to support all of these efforts, we also argue that Australia should commission a high-level panel of experts from multiple fields to independently make the case for a global fossil fuel phase-out on climate, environment, social, public health, and international security grounds. The report should be widely publicised by Australia and promoted through Australian diplomacy. Now, Australia did exactly this in the 1990s on nuclear weapons. When global nuclear arms reduction talks were deadlocked, Australia decided that the best thing it could do was shift the debate, and the Keating government established the Canberra Commission on the Elimination of Nuclear Weapons in 1995, which commissioned this expert panel to make a similar case for the elimination of nuclear weapons on security, public safety, health, environmental grounds. And this had an immediate impact in shifting the terms of the international debate away from nuclear reductions towards nuclear elimination. And it took on a life of its own. It spurred a lot of other countries to come out with similar reports and make similar public pronouncements about the importance of elimination, and led 3 years later to a UN General Assembly resolution on the elimination of nuclear weapons. And it just goes to show that this kind of unilateral leadership by one country, can actually have a life of its own, spurring all sorts of social and political action by campaigners, communities, and companies all around the world. And we argue that this is precisely the sort of thing that Australia should be doing on fossil fuels. Okay, to the other side of the equation, to renewable energy. Well, to illustrate what Australia can do on renewable energy to bring the prices down, we wanted to have a look first at what cloudy Germany did on solar PV. Now, Germany has already transformed the global market for solar PV cells. With just 1% of the world's population, up to 2010, Germany had deployed around 43% of the world's solar PV. Over just 6 years, solar PV system costs decreased 65%. So that if you bought solar panels 6 years ago, they would have been 3 times as more expensive as they are today. Now what this graph shows with price on the vertical axis and deployment of PV on the horizontal axis, that there is a strong correlation between deployment and price. Basically, for every doubling in deployment, the price of solar PV dropped around 22%. And the pace of this decline has taken everyone by surprise. Only a few years ago, the Australian government forecast that solar PV wouldn't reach parity with fossil fuels until sometime after 2050. Suddenly, parity has already emerged in many markets, and every major consultancy and government around the world has come out with bullish projections of immense PV scale-up over the next decade. Now, Germany's heavy lifting really was what spurred this. And it has really propelled solar PV prices to sail down their cost curve in a short period of time, and similar success has occurred on wind, thanks to Germany, Denmark, and a couple other countries. Now, solar and wind, the transformation in solar and wind markets is an incredible success. But if we're to ensure the decarbonisation of the world's stationary energy sector, it's important that we also develop a couple of other critical technologies, particularly concentrating solar thermal with storage and batteries that can compensate for the variable supply of the sun and the wind. Now, for these technologies to emerge, the International Energy Agency warns that we are falling desperately off track. So first of all, there's a severe global underinvestment that applies not only to research, development, and demonstration, which the IEA argues needs to rise around sevenfold, and we argue in the report that Australia should up its contribution to those efforts by contributing around $3 billion a year to RD&D. But most importantly, the shortfall is in deployment. And these existing technologies that are commercially available need to be deployed in order to bring them down their cost curves, as happened with PV and wind. Now, to put it in the words of leading climate analyst and author of Climate Progress, Joe Rom, the strategy needs to be deploy, 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 research, develop, deploy, deploy, deploy. So specifically, we argue that in order to replicate cloudy Germany's success on solar PV, sunny Australia should do the following things. Largely, on CST, we should implement the Stationary Energy Plan, which would deploy around 42 gigawatts of CST in 10 years. Now, the IEA argues that CST can become cost competitive with fossil fuel energy sources by 2020, with sufficient deployment, and an early analysis by Sargent and Mundy argue that this could occur with just 9 gigawatts of deployment globally. Now, we don't know precisely what it will take in terms of deployment in order to get grid parity with fossil fuels, but we do know that Australia on its own could possibly do it, or if not, certainly with a few other key countries that are already starting to invest in CST. So by itself, with a few few cooperation with a few key countries, we could actually make this a reality. Okay, so just finally, before I wrap up, we've made the case for why Australia can lead, how we have the power to lead in realising this goal. We also, in the report, talk about why Australia should lead. And I just want to touch on that briefly. So, there's a convergence here of both international responsibility grounds and national interest grounds. In terms of international responsibility, of course, Australia is a large historical emitter of greenhouse gases and a large current emitter of greenhouse gases, emitting well beyond our fair share. This is something that we've all heard before about why we have a responsibility. To that ethical justification, we also add the extremely large sphere of influence that I explained earlier over global emissions that Australia has, which adds to its case to lead. And of course, our special capabilities to contribute to global solutions, including our fossil fuel market power, our renewable energy resources and essential skills, and our financial capacity. We also argue that this is in Australia's national interest. When it comes to renewable energy ramp-up, rolling out the Stationary Energy Plan, which it showed, would have a net economic benefit for Australia relative to business as usual energy supply over 30 years. In addition, it would enable Australia to establish a leading position in global clean energy markets, forecast by HSBC to be worth $2.2 trillion by 2020. It would lead to substantial investment, jobs and export income. As the German example has shown, its policies currently cost around 9 billion euro, its smart policies that enable the deployment of PV and wind and other renewable technologies. So they cost 9 billion euro a year. They provide numerous benefits, including 10 billion euro in saved energy costs, 8 billion euro in avoided environmental damage, 25 billion euro in sales value of wind and solar, and 13 billion euro in exports, and 380,000 jobs created in renewable energy industries. And of course, they've transformed the world by bringing down the price of these key technologies. Now, for a country like Australia, it's often said we don't have the manufacturing flair that Germany has, but even if you were to accept that, and even if you were to accept that Australia would have no manufacturing jobs in renewable energy, which is unlikely, that we would have none, but there's still an enormous amount of value that Australia can capture. On solar PV, First Solar, one of the leading PV manufacturers, shows that for its value chain, around 75% of it is not manufacturing. And these are the areas where Australia can compete in research and development, design, finance, project development, operations, maintenance, software training, and more. For a services-based, sophisticated economy like Australia, we can capture a huge portion of this value. We also argue that the fossil fuel moratorium and fossil fuel phase-out are in Australia's national interest as well. And we point out a number of things that have been underplayed in the current debate about fossil fuels and climate change. Firstly, that the economic risk of investing in fossil fuels has been understated. Now, there are now a number of mainstream international banks, including Citibank and HSBC, that are already starting to talk about the fact of the overvaluation of fossil fuel extraction of fossil fuel companies, because they're not factoring in, markets are not factoring in, the need to stay within the 2 degree or less climate trajectory. So there's already starting in mainstream circles to be discussion about the risks of a carbon bubble in fossil fuels and trillions of dollars worth of subprime fossil fuel assets. And we also argue that the economic value of the fossil fuel industry has been overstated. We all know about the two-speed economy, the fact that the mining boom is driving up the exchange rate and causing skill shortages in the major cities and towns, which are hobbling out the non-mining economy in which 98% of the Australian workforce is employed, and having a huge detrimental impact on manufacturing, tourism and other export services. We also make the point about, of course, the boom and bust nature of the resource cycle, which actually, when it busts, exacerbates recession. This is the point that Dr. Ken Henry, former head of the Australian Treasury, has made repeatedly, that the mining boom did not save Australia from